Come on now.
We live in America. It's a great country.
has got many, many shortcomings, but it's a great country. And I'm proud to be called an American.
Amen.
But even more proud to be called a child of God.
Son of God.
Because everything that God has, all of the healing, all of the deliverance, all of the power, is at our disposal. Thank God for that. Anyone else? Unspoken request? I know there's always people that has things that they'd like to keep private, and that's all right. God, when you raise your hands, God sees that need, and He'll take care of it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we love you this morning. We come to you with excitement, godly, exuberant spirits this morning, because you are God. Lord, there's nothing that you can't do.
Lord,
you said when things are impossible with man, then they're possible with God. Help us to get that deeply ingrained in our souls, God, that you can do all things. We can do all things through Christ, who strengthens us.
God,
Paul said you're able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask you to think. I'm trusting you this morning. Every hand that was raised,
and expect to meet heaven there.
Never. We all got to get this for ourselves.
Yes. That's all it's all about.
And when you get it, Brother Rock, it's such a blessing to live
in, man,
and to know that the Lord is living through you.
Yes, Lord. this world. Because, brother, this world is not our home. We're just passing through.
We're out of here.
Our treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue.
In case of rapture, we're out of here.
We can have everything that the Lord has blessed us with when the rapture takes place on the way to glory.
That's the truth.
We have it, sisters and brothers.
You can have it. Just give me Jesus.
I don't care about it.
I only want him.
The Lord take us out of this torment place and bring us where we need to
be. I want out of the devil's playground.
To be with him and glorify by
him. I want to get out of the devil's playground.
Oh, Lord, you'll be happy. Yes, sir.
That's the truth. This is his playground.
My. I tell you what, we're just so blessed in the Holy Ghost. We're just so blessed in the Holy Ghost. But I want to turn to the book of Galatians, please, if you have your Bible, to the very first chapter. Oh, I have mercy. I want to begin reading at verse 6 through verse 12. That's Galatians chapter 1. Begin reading at verse 6 to verse 12. Thank you, Jesus.
Galatians.
It is Galatians.
And the word of the Lord reads this. I know that ye are so soon removed from him that called you to another grace of Christ. Unto another gospel. Which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and will pervert the gospel of Christ. And verse 8 says, but though you are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than which we have preached unto you, let us be accursed. As we said before, so say I now then. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. For to do I now persuade men or God? That's a question being asked, church.
Come on.
For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ.
You may be seated.
Oh, hallelujah. God. Hallelujah.
Ah.
Lord have mercy.
Shut up, Ohio.
Which is not another gospel than what you have been taught. What has been preached to you and to me from our pastor. There is not another gospel.
There is none.
Because we've been taught the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
That's the plan of salvation.
We was taught what it took to be saved.
Come on.
Not accepting the Lord as your personal savior.
That's the truth, Brother Zeno.
Not shaking a preacher's hand.
Come on. Amen.
We were taught that you need to be born again.
Come on now.
Of the water and of the Spirit.
Oh God, Jesus.
In the name of Jesus Christ. This is what we were taught. The plan of salvation, brother. There is not another gospel. For there is no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Only one. And his name is Jesus. No other gospel we're talking about this morning.
Come on.
No other gospel. Lord, have mercy, Jesus Christ. Verse 8 said, but though we are an angel from heaven, brother, a supernatural being, though he come from heaven, although you know that angel, if he come from heaven, it ain't going to tell us nothing that's contrary to the word of God. But the Bible says, though he come from heaven, teach or preach any other gospel, let him be accursed.
God's going to curse him for doing it.
I tell you,
I want to be blessed by you.
I'm just so cursed. I'm so blessed in the Holy Ghost and so are you, brother.
Lord, let
just a roll in by you. You know, God is going to hold us all accountable.
Yes, sir. That's the truth, Brother Zeno. Every word, every deed.
Because when much is given, much is required.
Every thought, God help me.
He didn't just save us and fill us and live through us.
Come on, Brother Zeno. Tell it now.
There's something that God sees within each and every one of us that we have to do for Him.
All right. That's the truth.
Just let yourself be applied to the will of God. Yes,
oh, God.
You never know whose lives you are affecting.
But watching you.
Walking this walk and living this life.
Help me.
Our people know church.
Don't let me fail.
You may be able to fool some of them sometime, but not all the time.
Your guard's going to go down.
But though we are an angel, comfort, help, preach, or teach any other God.
Oh God.
Then we have been taught. Yes. Let it be a curse.
Oh Jesus.
The good news. Yes. The Word of God.
My Lord and my God.
The Word of God. Well, I tell you what, I'm just so happy that God, I don't know what He saw in me. I can only speak for myself, Church.
That's the truth.
I like to use an example of myself because I know if anybody knows me, it's me. I can come there and paint a picture of you and be all torn out. God knows my heart.
Oh, Jesus.
He said the heart is deceitful, wicked.
Yeah.
And who can know it, brother?
That's the truth.
But the Holy Ghost.
Only God knows the heart.
But I'm so thankful that He's given me a chance to make heaven my destination.
Yes, sir.
It's up to me.
Yeah.
But He has given me the plan of
I choose you, Papa.
And He has given me His
Papa God, I choose you.
And I have His Spirit and so do you. We have all the good that it takes, my brothers and sisters.
Yes, sir.
To make it to
oh, heaven. Jesus.
And along the way, please, let's take someone along the way with us.
Come on now.
My Lord and my Lord, let's not be selfish with this Holy Ghost. And I'm speaking to myself. The Lord has been so good.
Yes, He has.
That's the truth for the team help.
As the apostle said, and as we said before, so say I now again.
Wow.
If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be a curse.
That's right.
Oh my God.
That's the cursing of God upon you.
Jesus.
You know the devil knew that Jesus was God.
Yes, he did.
He knew he knows that, brother. But He has blinded the minds of them that would allow Him to do it.
Throughout the world.
He told Jesus while He was on a fast, our Lord and Savior, turn these stone into bread. He knew He was hungry.
Feed yourself.
And He knew He was capable of doing what He asked. But yet He had the audacity and nerve to tempt the Lord. And all Jesus did is what He commanded His children, us to do.
Throw the word back in His face.
It's preach the word. Use the word that swore.
Throw the word back in His face.
Well, I tell you what, I shave in the morning. I'm thinking I'm getting you a good shave, but when you got a double-edged razor, brother, you got to be extremely careful, brother. These men know what I'm talking about.
You slit your throat.
You got to be extremely careful when you got a double-edged. Because that day when you're going down your face, you got to be careful. Because if one don't get you, the other one might get you.
Boy, it'll take you out.
But
But that Bible is a two-edged sword. It's cutting unto the asunder. I'm telling you, that Bible cutting both ways.
Deeper than deep.
And you and Jesus used the word of God on the devil. Just like we must use the word of God on the devil. Because we are no match for the devil. But we can do all things through Christ, which strengthens us according to the power that works within us. We know it's not us. We know it's the Lord Jesus that lives in us. It's the Holy Ghost.
All right.
That's keeping us alive.
Yes, sir.
The prophet Jeremiah says that fire should have been before.
Hallelujah.
This thing is real, church.
Amen.
You don't need nobody to tap you on the shoulder and say whether you're living for God or not. You are.
Truth,
let man examine himself. You don't need nobody to examine you, and I don't need nobody to examine me. I can examine myself.
I already know.
In the Spirit of God.
I know if I'm right or not.
No.
I'll
tell you what.
Yes, sir.
We're just so blessed. Just so blessed.
That's the truth.
So let's turn to the book of Romans, please. Romans chapter 8, begin reading at verse 26. We're going to read a couple of scriptures. Oh, Lord, Lord, Lord.
Dear God, Jesus. The Word. Hear the Word.
Yes, sir. It's forever settling and shining with you. Romans 8:26 reads this, my church. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmity. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And listen to what verse 27 said, and he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
Hallelujah.
And verse 28 is and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. All things work together for the good. I don't care how it looks. It's going to work out for the good if you let the Lord work it out for you. Just wait on God, church. Wait on God for our personal needs. Because all these things the Gentiles seek at, he knows that we have need of this and that.
Come on, what?
We don't have to beg him. He knows where we live. And he's going to fulfill the desires of our heart.
Hallelujah.
According to his word. If we but what? Delight ourselves in Jesus. The Bible says that he shall what? Give us the desire.
Oh God.
Just delight me. You know, Brother Paul, the Holy Ghost don't require much from us. But to live holy. Live a righteous life. And to be a witness in this lost and dying world.
Yes,
that they may see God through
yes,
us.
Sir.
The hope of glory to where they have a chance to be saved.
That's the truth.
Lord have mercy.
My God.
If there's anything that I want to do for God, it's to reach this dying world, church. I'm telling you.
Every nation and country.
Our soul.
Every backslider.
Our soul is worth so much to
us. Yes, it is.
Our families.
The Bible says that the angel desires just to look into this.
Yes, sir.
When one soul get right with
they long to be a part of it.
Although we do need, the Bible just said one, but it can be many more. But it only takes one.
Just one.
That will give up their will to do God's
will. My God.
Boy, it takes a man and a woman, brother, to live for God.
A real man and woman.
It takes a real, genuine person to stand up and go against the grain.
My
and
Jesus.
Stand and live for God. when all obstacles are totally loose. And we heard my pastor talk about his grandparents or his mother or whatever, that it put them out of the house.
Yep.
They had to go sleep and live with other relatives.
They couldn't live in their house.
Right then and then, you can see what was the news. But they stood. I'm telling you, they stood.
For the rest of their lives.
And because they stood and lived for God.
Every day of their life.
Look at the result.
Every one of them's inside the
church. That's why I said these old pioneers, they paved the way.
They blazed the trail.
They paved the way because they paid the price.
They blazed the trail.
They paid the price. I've heard preaching, I've heard men of God, and I'm telling you, man, that the hell is standing among them.
That's the truth.
On everywhere that it is. They would just stand up. So much anointing. Because they died out to this world. They died out to this world.
They disconnected.
They prayed. They fasted. They sought after God. And because of that, look at the result.
Because of their sacrifice.
And because of our lives and living for God, trust me, the result is going to come.
Our story is going to be for His glory.
But all things work together for the good church.
Our weakness is going
to them that love God and who are called according to His word. Remember, we were called out of
yes. He called us out.
And that word, brother, we were sinners.
You better believe it. That's the truth, Brother Zeno. How well do I know?
We need a Savior to save us from this dying present world.
He's our only
thing. And until people realize that they need help and they need a new experience with God. They need the Lord.
Yes, sir.
Living now and to change their lives. They're going to be forever.
My God, Jesus.
And I tell you what, man.
That is the truth.
I'm in a place right now. That don't make me no better than you, and you no better than me.
That's right.
Because we all lost. I'm in a place right now. I can say no senses.
All right.
What would I feel like to trample again over the blood of Jesus?
I don't want to trample through His blood.
Just for a little pleasure.
Jesus.
When my Bible said Moses rather than suffer.
It's like Charles. That is me.
For just a second. What if a man gained, he gained the whole world.
And still loses his soul.
And he loses his soul. What does he profit?
Oh, Jesus. That's a terrible
plan. What about that inner that's
worth
somewhere
it's not worth it.
Don't people think about
it. Not
we're not be only here temporarily. We're on borrowed time. We're not here forever, church.
That's right.
Our spirit has got to go somewhere.
God just put us here for a brief moment in time.
I tell you what, I just thank God. Let's turn to the book of Revelation, if you don't mind. Read chapter 5. Lord have mercy.
My God, Jesus.
Lord, 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 Lord. And the word of God reads this. Ye did run where? Who did hinder you that ye should not obey the truth? And got out of the race, they did well. They started. But who had run
true?
They got to take time to get rooted and grounded to find out what they had. Oh, Lord. You know that devil, I hit him with a passion.
That's the truth, Brother Zeno.
And just to think, Brother Ron, that the Word of God said, when we going to see
what he looks like.
What he looks like. We're going to say it, Pastor. Is that that you mean?
Is that? Yeah.
That's what
it was called. Given out. All the trouble. Yeah. You know, for the Word of God to say that, you know,
here by then.
Right.
But he wants the people to.
If you could actually see.
Hold on to the cross, children.
Yes.
Don't give up.
I'm not. I will not.
Because there is no other gospel.
That's right.
I pay my choice for going with you, Father. Going with you, Jesus.
Because at the name of Jesus, I promise you, according to the word of God, every knee gonna bow and every tongue gonna confess that he's Lord of all. There's gonna come a day if you don't believe and accept the word of God, there's gonna come a day when you stand before Jesus.
That's right.
And you're gonna say, my Lord and my God, and
it's all coming home.
Hoping that he taught me to me.
God help me.
Oh, Lord.
Help me.
Stay encouraged, church.
Help me.
Because there is no other gospel. My.
Help me, Father.
This persuasion coming not of him that called you, but a little leaven. Leaven the whole world. My. I'm just going to read a couple of scriptures, and we're going to go down and read some scriptures. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians, please. Chapter 11. Yes, Lord.
Oh my God.
There's no other gospel.
That's the truth, yeah, Martino.
That word of God is embraced so deep in me, I tell you what.
Amen.
Woo! Lord. Chapter 11, verse 3. Listen to what the word of the God, Lord says. But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety.
That's subtlety.
Subtlety. So your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ.
My God.
Listen to what verse 4 said, church. For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if ye receive another spirit which ye have not received, if anybody come preaching another gospel than what you have received, or if you receive another spirit that you have not received,
he's been cursed before he gets to you,
or another gospel which ye have not accepted, ye might well bear with him. For I suppose I was not a whit behind every chief as apostle. But though I be rude in speech, listen to what the man of God said, yet not in knowledge, but we have been thoroughly made manifest among you in all things. God have mercy.
My God.
But in knowledge. When I was reading that scripture, I thought about another scripture. The man of God, he prayed for three things. You know, if God was to ask you and I what we would desire and want, we all would have different needs, different wants. But in his situation, he said, Lord, give me wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Why did he want it there? To where he can lead the people of God.
That's right.
That's beautiful, children. He wasn't selfish, Brother Don, Brother Paul. He didn't think about himself. He thought about the people, the responsibility that was upon his shoulder. That's what he thought about. And because he didn't request anything else, the mercy and love of God, God just had it.
All right.
Just like he's going to add what he's got to add to each and every one of us. But I ask God to just give him wisdom, knowledge and understanding, and dealing with his souls, his babies. Because I want mercy to follow me, and I'm going to show mercy.
Yes, sir.
I'm telling you, what we so weak on me. Oh, Lord, have mercy.
God.
I got a burden of love for souls. I'm telling you. Oh, Lord.
Have mercy, Jesus.
Brother Paul, I wish I had one of them big old men and drive around, where I can just pick them up and say, don't worry about nothing. just get in. And we all come to the house of God.
Yes, sir.
Then after work, people taking their own personal vehicles, or some don't have vehicles. Can't stay home for different reasons. You know, Brother Paul, when the Word of God said He'll make a way where there seems to be no way, that's so beautiful. A bus ride, I'm telling you, that's precious, precious times. Lord, have mercy. Bible studies. Everything we do for the Lord is not in vain, because we have the gospel, the truth of God's word. And you know, church, I'm talking to myself. We owe the world that respect to give it to them. We owe that. Because we all want to be used by the Lord Jesus. And He's going to use us if we make ourselves by God. I thank God for His goodness, His mercy, His grace. I give it to you. I'll be honest with you. But that He said, but though I be rude in speech, yet not in knowledge. Lord, they that know their God shall be strong and do exploits. I tell you what, when you look all around you, people dying, people don't know what way to turn, and here you are, standing with Jesus. And you got peace in this in your storm. And you don't understand. Why are you so calm? And there's a raging fire, you know, they're fixing to burn everything. And here you are, you're calm. Because I read the Word of God where it said that Jesus got in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach. These boys were not troubled within themselves because they knew that the Lord was going to deliver. You know, I may be talking to myself. But when you know that you know that you know that God is going to deliver you and take care of you, why should I be worried?
That's right.
As the song we sing, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the waters. I shall not be moved when you know who can save you. God have mercy, Jesus. The good Lord is just easily good to me. I'm telling you, we bless going in and bless God. Oh, Lord. You know, we miss all grace. We really are. Because the Lord says He has us engraved in what? In the palm of His hand.
That's right.
One and beaten for nothing. Just knowing that living for Him, the best of our ability, and doing what we know to do in Him through His word.
Yes.
And look at this.
Yes.
The price that we're going to win sustainably. We're going to win Him. Just knowing this is easy. Causes us just to be a pliable. Whatever, Lord. What can I do for you? Where would you like me to go today, Lord? What would you have to do? Tell me. You know, I'm going to share something with you all. And this is personal between God and I. But I have that. You know what hurts me the most, but God? It's when I pray and I ask God, Lord, where would you like me to go or what would you have me to do? And sometimes, you know, I just don't get an answer. Sometimes I just gotta move by faith. That troubles me. That hurts me. Because I really want to hear where the Lord would want me to be and what He wants me doing at that time. Because I want to please Him right now. Brother, I want to please the Lord. Not man, no brother. I want to please the Lord.
Amen.
I got to hear these words well done. I'm sorry. This is why I live for God. This is why you live for God. And this is why we do and try to do the will of God. Because we want to hear His word, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Jesus is good, church. Jesus is good. Turn to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4. And let's read what that says. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Lord have mercy. Now therefore hearken, O Israel, unto the statute and unto the judgment which I teach you. For to do that, that ye may live and go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your father gave you. Ye shall not add unto the word, Lord, which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. How can somebody add to the word of God or take away from the word of God, knowing that God's word says, if they are Bible reading, that God will take them in out of the hand of the Lord. And they will still put their own two cents in there. And they know it's not engrafted in God's word. I'm speaking about church this morning. There is no other gospel, church. There's no other gospel. Lord have mercy. Let's just read a couple more scriptures. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're going to read verse 4. Let's turn to that right quick.
unless ye have believed in me. For I declare unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died.
Yes.
For our sins.
The truth did.
According to the scripture. This is what he did. He died for our sins.
That's right.
And that he was buried. He went the way of the grave. And that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
Yeah.
This is what he said. Keep this in memory. And that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12.
Wow.
Did you hear? This is the gospel that was preached.
The Lord.
The death, the burial, and the resurrection.
That's the truth.
There is no other gospel.
My Lord and my God, Jesus.
There is no one else. Keep in memory, church, the pure word of God. Don't add, take away from it, because we have it all. We have everything we need at our disposal to make heaven our home.
He's given us everything we need to
all
live for.
All we gotta do is do and fulfill the will of God in each and every one of our lives. To make this complete. Because we go on to the church. We go to a place we have never been. And once we get there, we're going to reign forever and ever and ever. Because there's no one else. And I thank God for you. I thank God for you all.
Hallelujah, Lord, Jesus.
Lord, you all. I hope that this
is my God. We've got to fall in love with the Word of God.
All over again.
Thank you, Lord.
If we don't, we're not going to make it.
That's the truth.
We need the Word every morning, and amen, every evening.
I need you.
We need that Word.
Yes.
I've got to have you.
The Word of God is able to change us. The Word of God is able to heal us.
Yes.
Praise God. All we've got to do is be able to trust Him.
Yes, sir.
He is the God that heals. He really is. Praise God. So good to see this baby. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
We're thankful this morning. We're thankful this morning. I thank the Lord for the good times.
Yes, sir.
And I thank you for the bad times.
Amen. Hallelujah.
The same God is the God of the world. He's the God of the bad. God's location, or our location, doesn't change God.
Not only.
It really don't. I was telling someone the other day, I don't remember who I was talking to, and I said, the valleys is where He restores our soul. David said He leads me beside the still waters. Make a bit of lay down and green pastures. We're in the valley.
Yes,
He restores my soul.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes we need our soul restored.
That's right.
Sometimes we need God just to get a hold of our souls.
Yes.
Because our souls get dry. Our souls get sick. There's nothing like a sick soul. But I'm thankful I know the healer.
Amen.
He said, I have sent my word and my word has healed you.
Thank you,
Brother Zeno, for the word of God this morning. It's good to see each of you here this morning. Once again, so good to see Miss Betty and see Joseph back. I drove in last night and saw his truck backing up. I said, well, thank God he got home. I know Charlene feels better when he's at home. Praise God. We're so thankful for all that God is doing.
My Lord,
we want our ushers to come, and we're going to sing, and we're going to take up our offering, our tithes and offering. Let's give this unto the Lord. I met a man yesterday. He was telling me he was raised in one religion, and he moved to another, and he moved to another, and he said, I'm not satisfied. I said, sometimes we need to look inside.
I said, you have to understand, anything that is got human flesh in it will have shortcomings.
That's the truth.
It really will. Because we are all lived in sinful flesh.
That's the truth.
I thank God, he said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Come on.
And I know I'm in weak flesh, but I want to keep the spirit strong. I then you can tell me whatever dog you feed the others will be the strongest. I want to feed this dog here with the word of God.
Amen.
I want my flesh to get the word of God. Worship with them as they say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
faith even walk.
Lord.
Without your holy mind. I'm a good brother, man. I don't want to walk without holy mind. I want the whole mind. And I make sure that he never says, praise God. We're so glad to be here this morning. Brother Jared, I have your baptism certificate. I forgot to give it to you last week. So before you leave, come pick it up. Praise God.
My God, you are
worthy. We're so glad to have each of you here in the house of the Lord today.
Amen. Hallelujah! Glory!
I don't know about you, but there's something about coming to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Meeting other brothers and sisters in the Lord.
Let your Shekinah fall.
I guess one of the things that I miss most when my parents died is that we as the children didn't all get together anymore. Mom and Dad was there. Thanksgiving or Christmas one, we was all at the house.
It was our rock.
You drive up to the driveway, you could smell. Now, it may not have been your ideal of a Thanksgiving, but we smell fried chicken on Thanksgiving.
I feel the Holy Ghost.
Mama had fresh mustard, fresh turnip greens. She had cornbread dressing.
Man.
I get thinking about it, I just get hungry, sister.
Woo! Fill her up.
Praise God. There's something about it, the family unit comes together.
Come on!
That's what I like about being in the house of the Lord.
We're in one
being
Lord.
My brothers and
we're
sisters
in one
my Lord. Praise God. When we were living in Virginia, I used to go and walk through Walmart when I first moved there because everybody goes to Walmart.
Walmart in the mountains.
I went there looking for some children of God. Drove around town. They didn't have a Pentecostal church. Matter of fact, they didn't have a whole lot of churches in that town.
Come on now, Pastor.
We drive down the roads here and we see giant cathedrals.
Everywhere you look.
And big, massive buildings. And
the Bible
Belt. I'm thankful to know this morning according to the Word of God. Those big, fancy buildings is not where God lives.
No, it's not the building.
This building here is not God's church.
That's
we
true.
Are. That's what we're studying
that's
right,
right
now. On Tuesday night.
We are His tabernacle.
It's so wonderful to be with the family of God. If you have your Bible this morning, turn with me to Revelation chapter 2, verses 12 through 17. God, it just keeps dealing with me about this.
Come on, Pastor.
I've been working on it. God's been giving me scriptures.
Help me, God.
I just felt led of the Lord this morning. I'm really not through with this, but I felt led that this morning was the morning.
It's time.
That I needed to preach this message.
It's time.
Revelation chapter 2, verses 12 through 17.
And
once again, good to see Miss Betty here today.
Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah.
It is in Missouri now. It's probably colder there than it is here. Quite a bit, yeah. I moved to Virginia. I had some long sleeve shirts.
I'm a Cajun boy.
I didn't care that cold. I said, it ain't gonna be that cold.
Fighting freezing cold.
First thing I had to buy would be a coat.
Your mouth was freezing cold.
Mr. Perkins called me that morning. I called her when I arrived and she said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm standing out here on an overlook looking at a place called Powell Valley. One of those beautiful places I've seen.
Gorgeous in Virginia.
And she said, how cold is it? I said, it's 31 and it's snowing.
It's biting cold.
And you're outside? I said, yeah, I got a long sleeve shirt on. And it's really not that bad. But the weather there is a different cold than it is here.
It's dry climate.
It's a drier cold. There's not all that humidity. She said, you going to catch your death of cold? I said, well, I won't have to buy me a hat and buy me a coat. I saw this and I had to stop and take some pictures. You come up over the top of that mountain and you look down across Powell Valley, it looks like you're looking at an ocean. As the clouds come down low, the valley is so deep down inside of that mountaintop. And when you look, all you see is just big white billowing clouds.
It's open to
rolling across that valley, and it's probably 11 or 12 o'clock in the day before the sun finally moves all that out where you can see.
Over the mountain peaks.
Once you can see, it's just a big, beautiful, green valley. Houses speckled out through there. In the fall of the year, it kind of runs, you should call it, what did you call that? Some kind of broody pebbles.
It looks like broody pebbles.
It was broody pebbles.
The leaves change.
All those different colors. Beautiful place. Revelations chapter 2, verses 12 through 17.
And to the angel of the church of Pergamum.
I want to read this not so fast. To the angel of the church in Pergamum. It wasn't the angel of Pergamum, but it was an angel that was in Pergamum. Right, these things said he which had a sharp sword with two edges. Brother Zeno spoke of that razor with double edges. Verse 13 said, I know thy works and where thou dwellest. I know where you're living at. Even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast thy name and hast not denied thy faith. Even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelt. Verse 14 says, but I have a few things
against thee.
Now notice this. God knows they've been faithful to the word. He knows they've stood firm. He knows there's things that they've done to please God. But he said, yet I have a few things against thee. Because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block
before the children of Israel,
to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. God said these are things that the church should not do. He said, you're doing it. Verse 15, so hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which things I hate. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against thee. I do not want God
to fight against me. No. Please, no.
God said the only way you can stop that is if you repent and quit doing those things.
Right.
He said, I will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Plural. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and a stone of a new name written, which no man knoweth, save he that receiveth it. He that receiveth it. When you get the Holy Ghost, nobody else may know. And he said, you will know.
That's the
stone he's talking about. He said, I give them a white stone. Stone in the Greek meant a heart, a soul, a spirit. And in the stone,
that's
a
the
new
stone.
Name written, which no man knoweth saving he ever seen. I want to preach to you for a little while this morning on hell's Trojan horse. Hell's Trojan horse. I wanted to put the Trojan horse of Troy up there this morning just to kind of as an accent, but was not able to get it up there. But I want to preach to you on hell's Trojan horse. What is that horse? Compromise.
It's a compromise.
Hell's Trojan horse. The thing that will literally destroy you.
The horse of compromise.
Is compromise. Let's pray. Lord, we love you this morning. We understand beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are here. God, that you love your people who are called by your name. God, I pray that you bless these people. Pray the blessings of God upon each and every one of their lives, upon their children's lives, their grandchildren's lives, because you said this promise is unto them, to you and to them that are far off, our children, our children's children. You made that promise, and I pray now, Lord, that you will bless them. Open our minds and our hearts up to what the word of the Lord is saying this morning. Don't let us just hear the word, but ask it in the lovely name of Jesus. We'll give you the moment of praise.
Jesus' name.
Everyone said amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Look at your neighbor. Say, beware of hell's Trojan horse.
Beware of the hell's Trojan horse.
In 1871, an American named Henry Schleicher began excavating on ancient city in Turkey. To the amazement of many, this retired businessman had discovered the lost city of Troy.
Wow.
Today you can still see the ruins of its towers and its walls, which were 16 feet thick. And these pews are 14 foot. So you add another couple foot on it. That's how wide their walls was.
Whoa.
Nobody was going to walk up and push them over. Nobody was going to drive an arrow through them. No stone was going to break them up because of the width of those walls.
Yes, sir.
According to Homer's Iliad, the Greeks besieged Troy for 10 years.
Sure did.
Without success.
Amen.
They threw everything that they had to throw at them. They tried climbing over those walls. They tried busting through those walls. They tried every known tactic known to them at that time. And for 10 years, the people, the city of Troy, sat inside safe. They could not get through to them. They said, we don't have to worry because our walls are too thick.
Wow.
After the death of the warrior Achilles, many wanted to give up the fight. But the king of Ithaca, Odysseus, came up with a plan to get the Greek army into the city of Troy.
Yes, sir.
He said, we can't tear them down from the outside. We can't get our arrows to them while they're on the inside. Their walls are too high and their walls are too wide and there's just no way to get to them. The devil has fought the church now for thousands of years. He tried every tactic he could, but thank God the church is still alive and well, and people are Troll! and they walked away, or sailed away. After leaving the horse at the gates of Troy, the Greek army sailed away. The Trojans, thinking the Greeks had given up, had left the horse as a gift. Brought the horse inside the gates.
Wow.
That night, while the Trojans were sleeping, the Greek ships quietly returned.
Come on.
The soldiers and the horse slipped out and opened the city gates. The Greek army quietly entered Troy and started fires all over the city.
Oh, wow.
History says the Trojans awake to find their city in flames. And as they tried to flee, Brother Zeno, they were killed. The story of the Trojan horse and the fall of Troy have come to represent subversion of anything from within. That's what was happening in the church of Pergamos.
Yes, sir.
Whereas Satan was trying to crush the Smyrnian church by persecution from without. Oh, and it was not successful. He was trying to collapse the Pergamos congregation through corruption from within. Please stay with me.
Come on, Pastor, preach it.
That's the way our enemy operates. He either tries to crush us with hardships and hostility. There's those of you that have walked through valleys. I hope I never have to walk through. But I am a rest assured that if I'm ever called upon to walk through, that the grace of God is able and sufficient to bring it through.
Hallelujah!
He either tries to crush us or corrupt us with compromise.
Oh God.
We need to take heed to the fact that what 10 years of outward solemn joy could not accomplish. One Trojan horse of compromise within the city destroyed it.
Oh God.
The Trojan horse of Pergamos was what Jesus called the doctrine of Balaam.
Yes, sir.
You go back and study it, it becomes a stumbling block to believers.
Oh Jesus.
Leading them to accept idolatry and immorality while trying to maintain their distinctiveness as Christians.
Oh God.
As we see from Scripture, the danger of the doctrine of Balaam is that it tries to wed the people of God.
All right.
To the ways of the world.
Come on.
That is something that has never worked. And God's word said, will never work.
Cannot.
God's people were to be a peculiar people.
Yes.
God's people were to be a distinct people.
Separate.
God's people, when somebody, we walk the streets of our city.
They see us.
We walk into a supermarket. When we walk into the store. When you go to a Walmart, or you go to Ralph's, or you go to one of these stores in town, people should be able to tell. There's just something different. I can't put my finger on it, but there's something different about these people. And he's holding his hand up. What do you do?
You stop.
Why?
He's authority.
You don't have to guess what he is.
You don't
have that 38 on his side, that 40 caliber, 45, whatever he's wearing. He's got a badge up here on his chest, and that badge says he is a man of authority. He is the man that takes care. Tires on pavement. That means stop. Because it is a symbol of authority.
Come on now, Pastor.
And you see a Marine with that white hat on, with that braid around the top, and he's in a dark navy blue jacket and slacks, and he's got that red stripe down his side. You don't go, oh, look at the Navy man.
No correction of heartbeat.
You see a guy in white. The pigs and a little white cap on his head, you know, oh, look at the army guy. anything by the way he talks. You want to go and ask him for it? Yes, ma'am, I can take you right where it is. You have a great day, ma'am. Yes, sir. Yes, they have that symbol.
It's engraved.
That uniform that tells you what they are. That's right, Charlie.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
And when we as the church walk out of the church,
come on now.
We go eat sometimes and you walk in and they say, oh, you must have been to church. So what makes you lay that old, y'all dressed up? I said, well, I went to a wedding. She said, well, you know, I have no boot deer. You must have been to church. Why? Because it's Sunday.
All right.
People look and they can identify us.
Yeah.
Peter said, come out from among them.
He
said, the Lord,
he
and be ye separate. Why? Because he said, you are a peculiar
yes.
people, a royal priesthood. We are not to worship any altars. We are not to worship. And it continues to happen in churches today.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Amen.
The doctrine of Balaam is still finding its way into modern congregation.
Being practiced today.
Opening the way for worldliness to destroy the people of God.
That's what's being practiced.
Amen.
He said there in Revelations, he said, I know where you dwell.
I know where you live.
It's location. You see, Pergamos was primarily known for one thing. Religion.
One thing only.
You can't only go into a city today. There's a church here, and there's a church here, and there's a church here, and there's a church over here. And there's nothing wrong with that. But what the devil has done, he has brought falsehood in.
Into our area.
Because of falsehood. I had a man tell me yesterday, I was in Lowe's, and I was talking to Brother Zeno about it, and he was ripping some wire under me for our speaker system, and we're going to go to work on that tomorrow. Praise God, hallelujah, by it. And he said, what are you doing with all this wire? I said, well, we got to run some wire. I said, we redid the church. It used to lay on top of the carpet. And we want to run it up across these beams and down and back in there. And I said, he said, what church? I said, it's the Pentecostals of Lydia. I used to be Pentecostal.
Whoa.
I said, really?
Oh, wow.
He said, I was born and raised in another religion. And he said, I left that. I went to Pentecost. And I left Pentecost. And I went to this one here. And he said, I'm not happy there either.
My God.
I said, well, I'd love for you to come. He said, I may do that.
Come on now.
I said, you struck out three times. I said, when you get up to that, you get three strikes. I said, but you're not out.
God says,
and he looked at me, and I could tell I was losing him, so I just brought it right on back down. I said, that, you know, he tried. I said, what was wrong with your first church? He said, didn't like it. I said, what was wrong with the second church? Got mad.
Whoa.
I said, what's wrong with the church you have now? I'm getting mad. I said, maybe you need to look on the inside. It's hard to look yourself in the mirror and say, you know what, buddy, you've been wrong. I told him, I said, churches, and I said, let me rephrase that. I said, religion, I said, because there's only, God said he built his church, singular.
Yeah.
And he said, where's that at? And I took him to Matthew, and he said, on this rock I will build my
church,
singular. And he said, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And he said, you know, I've been in church for 61 years and I never even read that scripture.
That's incredible.
61 years and never read that scripture.
Right.
I said, we have to look on the inside.
Yes, sir.
I said, churches, religions are made up of people.
Yes, sir.
You got any faults, Sister Victoria? Oh, yeah. You got any faults, Sister Ruth? Sure, we all do.
Thousands upon thousands.
I said, and when humans are involved, I said, that everybody's got faults. And I said, so you've got to quit looking at people and start looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Regions of all kinds thrived in Pergamos. Because Pergamos was a religious city.
Yeah, it was.
In fact, there is an ancient saying that whenever any kooky religious idea was expelled from some part of the world, it would always find its place at Pergamos.
That's the truth.
Something we must understand about ancient religions is that they were usually associated with immorality.
Every time. Yes, sir.
Have you ever looked and scratched your head lately and said, where are the morals of the people today?
Where are the morals?
There are no morals.
No more.
People just don't help people.
They don't care no more.
Everybody's out for uno number one. And let the rich suffer. That is a part of immorality.
It's their problem.
Ancient religions were always about Jesus, it was the capital of Satan's seat.
Whoa.
It was the location of his throne. It was the place in Pergamus is where the devil dwelt.
Where he lived.
The place that Satan called home. But God had a light in the heart of Satan's kingdom. And to that congregation, he said, I know thy works.
I know them.
Pergamus, I know your works.
Right.
And I know where you're dwelling at.
I know where you live.
Amen.
He knew what opportunities they had. He knew what obstacles they had to overcome. The culture. Culture is a terrible thing sometimes.
That's right.
Their culture was satanic. Their culture was immorality. Their culture was simply new Rome. It sounds like America and the rest of the world today.
American Idol.
Every time I pick up my phone, I see 13-year-old girl missing in Texas. 14-year-old girl missing in Mississippi.
Yeah.
Every day. What is it? It's immorality.
Yes, sir.
It's in 2019.
Yes, sir.
It is a sexual thing. Pergamus, he knew the kind of opposition they faced. God said, I know you got, people ask me, what's the dominant religion? I said, in our area, it's Catholicism. So that is the major religion in our area. Brother Billy Cole landed in Lafayette probably 20 years ago, 25 years ago, and when he got off a plane and they picked him up at the airport, he preached a Holy Ghost crusade that weekend in Lafayette. And he got to the pulpit that first Friday night. He said, I got off the plane today here in Lafayette. He said, when I stepped out of the plane, he said, there was a bombardment of satanic spirits that confronted me.
At the doors of the airport.
He said, I've been in Thailand. I've been in overseas 30-something years preaching. And he said, I've seen just about every kind of demon that you could ever hope to run into. He said, but when I stepped out here in Acadiana, he said, I've never felt the satanic spirits that was against me. And he said, I've come to tell the church today. Church of Pergamus to have the assurance that he knew where they were and what they were up against. I'm telling you, the Lord knows what we're battling.
Here in
the spirits. Paul said we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spirits and principalities and wickedness. He said, you got to tear that panel. Jesus said, I am the way maker. I am the way maker. God said, I'll tear those forces of hell. They're walking. He said, they were firm in their devotions. He said, you hold fast my name. In their personal lives and in their public ministry, the name of Jesus was lifted high.
Yes, sir.
Everything they did was identified with Jesus Christ.
Everything.
And I believe that's where the church in Lydia is at. We try to do everything that we can to help people. We try to lift up the name of Jesus.
Yes.
They maintain sound doctrine. He said, you have not denied my faith. This was a church that clung to the fundamentals of the faith.
To their diet.
And would not compromise one precious doctrine of the Word of God, even when public opposition and satanic oppression
come
together to bring about the martyrdom of one of their most faithful members. What we see in Pergamus is a church that was unashamed of their Christianity. Unwavering in their doctrine. If you had attended one of their services, you would have sung songs of praise and worship.
Hallelujah.
Heard genuine prayer on Sunday evening that sprung from the heart and heard teaching that was doctrinally sound.
Amen, Pastor.
They were preaching the gospel, worshiping Jesus. They were in need of repentance because they had compromised with the world.
I will not compromise.
Hell's Trojan horse sits at the door of your heart and he wants to try to get a foothold. inside. Your people, be careful of what you listen to.
What you want.
Be careful of what you look at. Be careful of friends that you make. They are Trojan horses sometimes, trying to get a foothold in your life.
What you read, what you watch, what you hear.
But they were so good, Brother Perkins. What was their era? The doctrine of Balaam. Balaam was an Old Testament prophet.
My God.
You go back into the book of Numbers. His story begins at Numbers 22. The Israelites in their wilderness wandering had come to the borders of Moab. They had just conquered the Amorites, and it looked like Moab was their next target. So the king of Moab sent messengers to Balaam to hire him to curse the Israelites. You cannot curse what God has approved.
Amen.
We'll say that again.
You cannot
curse.
You will not.
What God has approved.
That's right.
You shall.
I don't care how much you say. I don't believe it. That don't change.
It don't matter.
I don't care if there are 10 million people doing it. Don't make it right.
That's the truth, Matthew. That's the gospel truth.
He said for Balaam, God told him, don't go. Balaam.
Don't you go.
Got some more money together. And before Balaam answered the messenger, he prayed and asked God what he should do. And God told him he could not go with them or curse the Israelites.
You cannot do it, Balaam.
They got some more money, and that's what Balaam told the messengers. He refused to go with them, but they didn't want to take no for an answer, so they upped the ante. Balaam went, and along the way, God sent a messenger to Balaam.
Yes, sir.
The angel of the Lord, and as a result of that encounter, Balaam confessed his sin and offered to return back home.
I want to go back home.
Instead, the angel of the Lord told him, you go with the Moabites, but you only speak the words that God gives you to say.
And nothing else.
Balaam obeyed, and instead of cursing Israel, he blessed them.
He blessed them over and over again.
Four times he blessed Israel. And throughout the process, he upheld chapter 22-24. But I want us to go to Numbers 25, verses 1-3.
My God, Jesus.
The Trojan horse of Moab was their daughters.
It was the daughters of the city.
The Trojan horse of the Moabites were their daughters. Yeah. Let's read.
And Israel abode in Shechem. And the people began to commit whoredom with the daughters of Moab.
Stop.
Houses of ill repute.
Walking down the street, a beautiful young lady comes by.
Prostitutes.
The guy looks at her, and when he got back, it looks like that in Israel.
Prostitution.
You know why? Because the Israelites lived holy.
That's right. Amen.
They didn't dress like holy. That's the first time that young man had ever seen the bend of the knee.
That's the truth.
So he turned around and went the other way. He said, where are you going? Oh, I forgot something. He's following that Moabite.
He takes another look.
That Moabite was a Trojan horse. You know what? That young man married her.
Prostitute.
They had children.
Uh-huh.
Guess what the children began to learn about the God of Moab? The daddy was out in the fields working somewhere, and the mama had that baby, a baby that was half Israelite, but that baby was being taught to be a Moabite. That Moab young ladies became the Trojan horse. They walked right into the middle of the Israelites and began to destroy the one God message.
Prostitution.
Young men, young women, you better be careful.
No prostitute.
You better be careful. I don't know. I don't care how long her eyelashes are.
I don't care.
If she don't believe, hear old wisdom, the Lord is our God is one. You let her run. That is a Trojan horse. They invited him to their sacrifice feast full of immorality and adultery. And soon the men are eating at the table of false gods. Sleeping in the beds of pagan women.
Yes, sir.
And bowed themselves down to worthless idols.
Of stone and wood.
Numbers 30, 1, verses 13 through 16. How did this happen? Read. Verse 13.
And Moses and Eleazar,
the priest, and all the princes of the congregation went forth to meet them without the camp. And Moses was wroth with the officers of the host, with the captains over thousands and captains over hundreds, which came from the battle.
And Moses said unto them, have ye saved a woman alive?
Y'all didn't kill these young women? Well, Chief Moses, that's your birdie. You were told to kill everybody.
I told you what to do.
Why did you save them? You see, the counsel of Balaam. Balaam held fast the name of the Lord. He would not deny the word of God, but he taught Balak, the king of Moab, to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel.
Oh, God.
What was the stumbling block? The young ladies from Moab. To keep from losing the reward he had been offered. Balaam had offered him. Balaam sent the women to seduce the men of Israel to make marriage with them and to blend with them. It was a teaching that attacked the separation and sanctification that God expects his people to maintain.
Oh, God.
I just want to hang my hat just a minute. Dry my tent stake in right here. God expects us.
Expects.
Repented. Holy Ghost people, baptized in Jesus' name, living holy and righteous. He expects us to live that life. It's not just on Sunday and Tuesday night in the church. God expects us to live our lives.
Amen. Amen.
That's the doctrine of faith.
Oh, God.
It's teaching the people of God can mix with the world and still maintain
still be okay.
Their Christian teachings, their Christian distinctiveness. We are being taught that we can take the music of today
and blend it with us.
And blend it with some words from the Bible, and it becomes holy. Fads and fashions of the world and mix it with the Bible truths, and that will make it Christian. Someone called me the other day and said, have you heard this lady sing? That she is so anointed. She was number one singer. Oh, you need to hear her music. I said, I'm not trying to be disrespectful. The music is nice. But I said, look at the tabloids of her life after she gets through singing. I'm not a politician.
It's the world's
I hate politics with a purple passion.
I can't stand politics.
But I, as an American citizen, it is my responsibility to vote. And I can't vote for somebody that teaches about abortion.
I can't vote
for somebody that believes it's okay for men and women, for men and men to be married and women and women to be married. I'm sorry. The Lord translated the prophet of the Lord into the But once a month, we have somebody in our ministerial federation preaching, and we'd love you to come be a part of it. I said, you know what I preach.
You know what I stand for.
Now, he said, just on that day, can they keep it generic?
No, sir.
I said, thank you for calling me.
But I'll
see. But I am not a generic preacher.
No. I will not water it down. I will not.
But I'm not a generic preacher. I said, God did not call me to be generic. I said, I will be wise and a servant and harmless as a dove. But I cannot change what God has put on the inside of me. He said, here over and over, Lord, our God is one. And I've got to preach that wherever I go. He said, if you'll preach the name of Jesus, he said, I will lift it up. I will draw all the air. I tell you, just being generic will draw the fire. You've got to be firm on this. There is no truth and harsh coming in.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Some of you may have seen the article, I think it was just this last week. Has merged with Muslim leaders, and he said it's the formation of a one world religion. Turn to Matthew and you'll find where the Lord said that right before he comes, he said there's going to be a one world religion. I'm telling you, God's on his way. There's no time to let a broken horse get on the inside of you. By showing the stone, they can expect to be received and be given friendship and hospitality anywhere they went. I don't know about you. I've lived in several different places in my lifetime. And you can always, when you walk up to somebody, your spirit just agrees with them.
It connects. There's a connection.
It just agrees with them. What Jesus was telling us is that the person who rejects the friendship of the world will enjoy the unique friendship of God.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I'm laying in my chair. my leg would be hurting. And it's just such a blessed relief. I just crossed my leg and I put my hand where it's hurting and I begin to pray. And most times, that leg would just ease off and I'd walk to sleep. Bunny can't sign that.
No.
Jesus said, if I abide in you,
yeah.
If my word abides in you, in and him. You abide in me, you can do what? Ask what you will,
yes. And it
shall be given.
I'll give it to you.
Shall be given.
I'll beg from heaven.
There's no Trojan horse of Troy. What Pergamus teaches us is that we can boldly call ourselves Christian and hold to the fundamentals of the faith.
Oh,
the inspiration of Scripture, the deity of Christ, the virgin birth, and lose the blessings and friendship of God by refusing to maintain our separation from the world and its ways.
Yeah.
Compromise is the Trojan horse of hell.
Yeah.
Oh God.
I'm not just talking about just for me, for you. Anybody that's been filled with the Holy Ghost,
that's right.
There's a Trojan horse
trying
to get inside.
Hollywood politics.
And when they get on the inside, we rebel against the Word of God. When that Trojan horse unloads its cargo inside of us, we rebel against the Word of God.
Yes,
sir. I was teaching a Bible study here a while back, and a guy looked at me and says, "But I don't believe." I said, "That's okay. God's word is true whether I believe it or I don't."
I did believe it.
I said, "You see, you not believing this scripture does not make it false."
It don't make it any
false.
Let's stand.
It's just as
compromise is the Trojan horse.
I will not compromise.
Of hell.
I will not let.